So Brady and I were artists in residence at the Bentway in Toronto a few years ago, and it was a research residency, so most of what we were doing or expected to do was just sort of spend time on site and think about the sonic environment of the Bentway. And then one day one of us put our ear up to these big drainage pipes that come. So for those of you who don't know the site, the Bentway is a public space that's underneath this elevated expressway in downtown Toronto, right by the waterfront. And so the when it rains, the water collects on the overpass and then gets channeled into these big pipes that drain it down to the ground below. They make this incredible sound, you put your ear up to it. This passive resonance, like so unamplified sound, the pipes kind of change the sonic environment by basically like tuning all the sounds that are happening around you. And so the idea that kind of germinated from that was that if we could make these pieces that kind of prompted people to listen to the site through these resonant tubes that are very, very musical and very pleasant to listen to, then they might start to mistake the actual infrastructure of the Bentway for artworks themselves, and then vice versa. So the piece that I think succeeded the best in that was, it was kind of the keystone, was the piece that if you experienced that, then there's kind of no doubt that this was an artwork. And so we had these five pipes that were cut to different lengths. So the pitch of a pipe is a function of how long it is. So we calculated what the notes would be in length for these five pipes, to play the first five notes of this Bach organ piece, which is kind of an Easter egg riff on that, because you know, pipes and pipe organs, so it's using the same principles for resonance. But also Bach was kind of mischievous and would encode Bible verses and stuff in his music, and so we thought it'd be funny to encode Bach into the pipes. So this guy approached this person working at the site and said, when you put your ear up to these sculptures, they play music. And she said, well, yeah, that there's sculptures made by these artists. There's another one over there. And he looked over and saw the other one and said, but that's the plumbing. So he was confused about what was art and what was infrastructure. And then even the director of the Bentway, she asked me one day about this one that I put out, this little guy, and she's like, oh, I like the new one, the little guy. And I was like, yeah, that's attached to a bigger one. And she said, but I thought that was the plumbing. So even the director of the site was starting to get confused about what was art and what wasn't. And I guess the spirit behind that gesture is it's such a big monumental site that any kind of intervention that would compete with the scale of it, like sonically or visually or whatever, would just be, it'd have to be enormous and expensive. And so we thought, if we can rechannel some of the things that people are activating when they're engaged in interacting with art, like curiosity and, you know, openness to new experiences, that maybe we could have these pipes sort of, first of all, transform their relationship to the plumbing, and then maybe have them going around asking, like, well, what else is art? If the plumbing is art, then maybe the garbage cans are art. Maybe the boardwalk under my feet is art. So the white PVC pipe is conventionally used to vent furnaces. So you'll see it on lots and lots of homes in Ontario. Any home that's heated with a gas furnace, the moisture that it generates gets expelled through those vents. So we installed this one here, which looks kind of like a functional furnace pipe, but it's not. It's just buried in the ground. And so in the way that the Bach pipes were supposed to generate this understanding that there's this musical event, that would then get transposed to all the other pipes, what's happening here is visually we're counting on this pipe to read as a functional furnace vent, which then makes this one next to it into a very strange kind of thing, because it's clearly not a practical plumbing solution, which then makes this turn into something else. So, we most of the sort of conceptual thought and effort in this piece went into figuring out how to not have it be like an incidental piece, because one thing I talk a lot about for my work is that it's generally very, very site-specific, and so in the art world, we often talk about the white cube. So the white cube is a kind of architecture for a gallery, you know, white walls, hardwood floors, and the, historically and ideologically, the function of the white cube is to be neutral. So you make a sculpture and put it in a white cube, and whether that white cube is in Tokyo or South River or Toronto or wherever, it doesn't really matter. Context is not important. And I feel like when you're not taking stock of context, you're leaving out so much of what can power a work, like the site, the architecture, everything about the context is part of the work. We're just kind of trained to ignore most of what's going on in our work, potentially. Yeah, so what happens is when you put your ears up to the pipes, these ones I think probably work the best sonically. And you hear, so they're tuned, I think ones that have sharp ones and G. And so when you listen to one on either side, you get this minor second interval, and everything that's happening sonically in the area gets filtered through the sound. So this work, in a sense, in relationship to my work in architectural acoustics, architectural acoustics is often like, it's more like the art of like creating these spaces for sound rather than creating spaces that sound themselves. Some people come to architecture to make noise, and architectural acoustics itself is sort of this practice of making these sort of these passive spaces that essentially are like these analog filters that filter sounds in different ways. And these works here and the works that you know, at the Bentway are also functioning in this similar way, that they're these analog filters for sound, and except we get to like play with them in this more creative way. So not only are they very site-specific, as Richard was saying, but they also have like directional characteristics, and sculptural characteristics, and musical characteristics as well. So they not only have this sort of physical property of like resonance of musical notes, but they also filter the very site-specific sounds that are happening in the environment, whether it's cars going past, or people playing the ruined piano, or people walking by, footsteps, etc., get filtered through these devices, and then end up with this listening experience in your ears.
So air is always vibrating. Mm-hmm. Always, always, always. Like, so there's no resonance right now, because there's no accumulation of energy. So inside a pipe, the air in the pipe is always oscillating. And so you because of the geometry, because of how the sound, the standing waves are reinforced, that's why you get this drone. So it doesn't need any activation. Like any, if you, there's certain, like if it's too short, then you won't hear much. So the shorter the length, the higher the pitch. If it's too long, then the wave is too low and long for you to hear. So there's a kind of a sweet spot where you hear it. We're not trying to make a musical instrument exactly, and we're not only trying to make the sonic intervention here. On the other side, there's a piece that is three kind of like periscope type coming out of the ground, and it'll pretty clearly read, I think, to most people as you see these in children's playgrounds a lot, like sort of periscope pipes that go down into the ground and come back up, and you talk into them. What's cool about these ones is that they pick up some of the resonance of the pipe, but they don't really make much sound until you activate them. So, like, that's another situation where we're kind of counting on the way that people read it as a genre of object to understand how they use it. So people, I think most people will go up to that and start, you know, speaking into it, making noise, and they're like, oh, this pipe sounds really interesting when I yell into it, or when I put my ear up to it. So maybe I'll go around and put my ear up to all of them. And then they notice that all the pipes have these ear stickers on them.